Paltrocast.
How are you doing, Darren?
Rusty, because I'm speaking with you, it is a great day. Admirer of your work for decades. I mean, unfortunately, I'm one of those people that goes back in fear of a black hat. So we're going to ask you about that later, but
that's fine. I love talking about Fear of a Black Hat.
Well, anyway, 57 Seconds is the new movie. And for you, it seems like very new territory. You know, I'm very aware of the comedy you've done, the horror, Tales from the Hood, etc. Is this the first fleshed out sci-fi thriller work you've done?
Yeah, it absolutely is. I guess the closest I've gotten to sci-fi is maybe one of the episodes of First Tales from the Hood, where we had Lamont Bentley in the gang episode kind of spinning around with Rosalind Cash, and that whole thing was kind of like a Clockwork Orange vibe. But it was a lot of fun. I mean, sci-fi and horror to me are kind of like adjacent, kind of those sci-fi sometimes has more grounding in reality than horror tends to. And that was one of the things working with our lead in this, we had to kind of accomplish, because he really wanted to have some horror. Some true science involved in the film. So we had to kind of figure out how real science connected to going back in time, which was a little bit of a a little bit of a challenge, but we managed to do it. Morgan Freeman, there, because he was the one that wanted to do that.
Well, Morgan plays into the compliments here, as do you. So not only is an excellent concept in this guy's opinion, but visually it looks very stunning. It looks like if this movie were made 15 years ago, this looks like a $200 million movie. So did you know that the visual effects were going to be so great when the script is being helmed?
Hopefully, you know, there are even some things that I wanted to do that I couldn't do because of our budget limitations. But, it was important to have something in there that kind of gave you the feeling of Franklin, which was Josh Hutcherson's character, what he was feeling when he was tapping the ring, this kind of slightly weird out of body experience that he was having. And thanks to the work with my DP, we were able to we did some of that stuff in camera, and then some of the stuff landed on the VFX side. But, I think it works. You always wish you had more money to do bigger, but, you do what you can. And I think it serves the story. I mean, I think the story still manages to come through in how we portrayed the VFX with the ring.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not knocking it. I don't look at it and go, oh, they could have spent more money on X, Y, and Z. So take the damn compliments, Rusty.
Okay, I'll take it. That's fine.
And then in terms of the cast, I mean, most films, just putting Morgan Freeman alone sells it. Josh, big name. But Greg, are there a lot of people who are better movie bad guys than Greg? I don't think there are.
I don't know that there are. I mean, he was really perfect for the role in so many ways, and you know, nice guy in person, but somehow on screen this character that you just love to hate comes across really well, and I think Greg he did a great job for us, and it was important to have an antagonist that Franklin could really fight against, you know. And also it was important to have him because he kind of sets up where Morgan's character, where he kind of lands as well, because he kind of looks like he's an angel of sorts, and then you kind of realize that maybe he's not quite what we thought he was at the beginning either. But it helped having Greg's character be so hateful.
Well, something you just said about Greg being a nice guy in real life, I've never met a movie or wrestling bad guy that in real life wasn't the nicest, sweetest person on earth. It's always the protagonist stars that are saving the world that in real life are awful.
Well, let me I would agree with that, and with the disclaimer that Josh was also one of the nicest actors I've ever worked with in my life, and truly super talented. I was really fortunate that our entire cast was really on top of things, open to what the script was asking them to do, across the board, and it made my life a lot easier because, you know, we only had 18 days to shoot this film, and there's a lot going on. So being able to get in, do the work, and move quickly was paramount.
Got it. Well, again, a compliment is coming. It does not initially sound like a compliment, but I first discovered your work through Fear of a Black Hat, as I mentioned before. And then being a big Chappelle Show fan, Rusty did that too. When I was watching the credits, I had no idea at the beginning that you were involved with that. So your success predated the internet, or at least it predated social media the way that we know it. Yeah. So where I'm going with that is, I have the hunch that your IMDb is really incomplete. It doesn't have a lot of the things that you developed, a lot of the things that didn't go, et cetera. Am I wrong about that? There's a lot of unreleased Rusty Cundieff?
Yeah, there's a lot of scripts on the shelves back here that, maybe one day if I get fortunate, we'll land someplace. And actually, right now I'm trying to work on some short stories. I'm kind of working in reverse. You know, usually people take short stories and then they turn them into scripts. I'm taking some of my scripts and turning them into short stories, mainly because I'm too lazy to try and write a novel or even a novelette or anything.
I'm not calling you lazy. You call yourself lazy.
Yeah, no, I trust
me. Your output is, even if it's incomplete on IMDb and all that and Wikipedia, it's still fairly active.
Yeah, I'm still moving and trying to do things. And yeah, I have like had one of those odd careers where I've kind of touched a lot of different genres. I mean, right now I'm finishing up a rom-com that I'm working on for Netflix. And
that must be your first rom-com.
No, actually. And don't feel bad that you didn't see this, because this wouldn't be particularly probably in your wheelhouse. But after, I guess it was after Tales from the Hood, I did a movie called Sprung, which was a rom-com. And I was in it opposite Tisha Campbell, and we had Joe Torre and Paula J. Parker in that thing. So I've done rom-coms before. And, everything brings with it a different kind of challenge. But I would definitely say that, my comedy, horror, and, now sci-fi, the sci-fi thrillers, I've always wanted to do something that was more like a thriller. 57 Seconds kind of touched that pole for me a little bit. And hopefully I get to do some more, because manipulating, kind of expectation is fun. I mean, you do it in horror, you do it in comedy in a certain way, but thrillers have kind of a different vibe to them that's more fun. And I think in 57 Seconds, the scene where Franklin is going down the hall to kind of break into the safe was one of my most favorite things that I've directed. Because I was directing it, and at one point, I think because of our budget constraints, they were like, you got to pull some of those beats out. And actually what I did was we pulled them out of the script, but my DP and I kept a separate secret script. So on the day, we just shot what we wanted to shoot, because we knew it was a great fucking little scene within the film, and we weren't going to give that up.
Well, exposing my nerdiness there, I'm one of the people that watched the director's commentary on Fear of a Black Hat. And when you're talking about budgets, I love the factoid that you said that you weren't allowed to say that it was a $1 million budget. So you had to say it was a $999,000 budget.
Yes.
So it sounds like you just have career long run of like making things look cheaper than they were. or dealing with budget constraints, and then the studio having to apologize after the fact because they made their money back and then some.
Yeah, it's you know, I keep waiting for that $50 million movie, which isn't even that much nowadays, by the way. $50 million is, I guess, kind of like a medium budget film in some respects when you look at, you know, what's out there. So, but yeah, I've learned to do a lot with a little, and most of the films that I've been involved with, Tales from the Hood, perhaps being the odd exception. I've had, you know, we didn't think that was a big budget film when we did it, but, it would be my biggest budget today, even though the dollars don't line up. I think, you know, Tales was about a $6 million budget, but taking into account the change in what the dollar is today, yeah, the fact that we did it non-union, not actors, but crew, I've been told by PMs that today it'd probably be around $18 to $20 million to make that same movie. Of course, we had a lot of practical effects in there, which I think we only had one digital effect, or if you want to even call it digital, it wasn't even digital. It was just a painted tongue coming out of Clarence Williams III's mouth at the end of it. But everything else was practical, which I actually kind of like. And, you know, I enjoy the practical effects a little bit more than the digital.
Cool. Well, a couple of promised Fear of a Black Hat questions before I let you go. And again, keep saying the name 57 seconds, 57 seconds. You need to see it, etc. So I've had the pleasure of interviewing some of the people that you kind of lampooned in the movie, like Ice-T and Flavor Flav, etc. One thing I've never heard talked about is how the people that you kind of lampooned, including PM Dawn, etc., received the movie. Did they genuinely like it?
I've heard that most did. I met Eazy-E. He liked the film. I know that I've met Ice-T on a few occasions, and almost worked with him on something. Actually, well, did work him when I was shooting Chappelle's Show, because he was
The Player's Ball.
Yeah, the Player Haters Ball, yeah. So, and, you know, he seemed totally cool. And so I haven't had anyone like roll up on me and like, yo, man, we're going to have to kick your ass. That hasn't happened. I had heard that, I don't know if it wasn't PM Dawn. I get everything secondhand, you know, they're like, oh, we talked to so-and-so and they really liked it. So for the most part, I would say that it was fairly well received in that community. And, you know, no one came after me, which is the big thing. So,
yeah, if anyone would have, it would have been Easy E.
If anyone would have, it would have been Easy E. And he is like the one, yeah, other than Ice-T, the one person who I directly ran into. I was actually doing a signing of, I don't know, some promotional signing thing. And he was doing a promotional signing thing. Tells you how long that ago that was. But he came and he said, hey, man, that shit was funny. So it's like, okay, thank you, sir.
I just realized accidentally I'm wearing a Spinal Tap shirt. I did, coincidence there. Did any of the Spinal Tap people ever reach out and go, we like what you did with that relation to that film?
The closest that I got to that was I had a project. I was working on a script that Rob Reiner was interested in for a hot second. And so I had a couple of meetings with Rob Reiner, and he hadn't seen Fear of a Black Hat, but I told him, I said, yeah, I did my first film was kind of like an homage to Spinal Tap, which I loved, and so on and so forth. And that was a great thing. And I kind of explained the movie to him. And I did all this. And then he said, well, did you get paid? And I said, yes. And he said, well, you did better than me. So I was like, okay.
Yeah, that's something that people don't realize, how successful Spinal Tap was, but they only started litigating and getting paid maybe in the last 3 years. That was 40 plus years of pro bono work for all of them.
Right, right. So, you know, the film business can be tricky on that side of the aisle. But yes, I was such a huge, obviously, a huge Spinal Tap fan, so. Still one of my favorite films that I can watch over and over.
The last question I have for you is, you're originally from Pittsburgh, or at least you're associated with Pittsburgh, and now it's totally normal to hear that entertainment people are from Pittsburgh. But growing up, was there a local filmmaker or somebody that you looked at and went, they made it, so therefore I can too?
You know, I didn't look at it that way, but I was very well aware of George Romero, who was actually, I don't know if he started out Canadian and ended up in Pittsburgh, or started out in Pittsburgh and ended up Canadian. But
that was the most fear of a black hat explanation I think I've ever heard.
Yeah, kind of true. But yeah, when I was in high school, George Romero was making his follow-ups to he was doing, I can't, what was the first one? Was it Dawn of the Dead? Or I can't remember.
Music Park or Dawn of the Dead, one of those.
Yeah. Yeah, and he had done some other, he had done some other stuff around Pittsburgh. But I actually had some of my classmates, and I know Greg Nicotero is. I went to school, same high school as Greg. And those guys actually were going out to the mall at night after school to be zombies in the big mall scene that George was shooting out there. So I was very aware of George Romero, and was a big fan of his early work. So I guess that that has something to do with it. Maybe in the back of my head, I never really thought of it that way, but he definitely had an influence on me.
Was Tom Savini also a Pittsburgh guy?
I think I'm pretty sure he was, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah.
So you, those two guys, then weirdly there's that horror museum in the mall. Is Pittsburgh the secret horror capital of the U.S.?
I don't know, but I think that for some reason, I think that they're doing something at Pitt, at the university. They're teaching some course that deals with horror, I do believe, if I'm not mistaken. If nothing else, Pittsburgh being one of the older cities in the country, like a lot of places on the East Coast, I grew up near three cemeteries. Literally my house was a block away from three different cemeteries. And then there was woods down here and a weird lady that lived in like a little cottage. She seemed to be a witch. She felt like a witch. I don't know. We didn't know what the heck she was. So there's a lot of, Pittsburgh is very old, and along with antiquities and age seem to come ghosts and weird things. So I don't know.
My wife's favorite movie, The Deer Hunter. That's also the Pittsburgh relic kind of stuff. So anyway,
that's right.
Congrats on 57 seconds. Thank you for the decades of great art, and really looking forward to what's to come from you, even if it is a rom-com.
I appreciate it, Darren. And Darren is a good name. My producer and co-writer on Tales from the Hood was Darren Scott. So, and he also produced Fear of a Black Hat for me. So I'm fond of almost anyone named Darren.
My middle name is Scott, so I take that with great homage and pleasure to know that I indirectly played a role in the great Rusty Cundieff.
I appreciate it, Darren. Thank you very much. Paltrocast.